Well, if you think about breaking an addiction to, say, something like chocolate, okay, we'll just use this as an example. If you're addicted to chocolate and I slid a chocolate cake in front of you, the moment you saw that chocolate cake, your brain would start saying, oh my God, you know, I want a piece of chocolate. Everybody else is eating chocolate. It's not that bad for you. I can start tomorrow. And your body would automatically, physiologically respond in the presence of that chocolate cake without your conscious mind. In other words, if you're addicted, it's going to happen automatically. So then, if you broke the addiction to the chocolate cake, literally did not have any addiction any longer, if I slid that chocolate cake in front of you, you could eat it or not eat it, and you would have no response, okay? In other words, you would have no physiological... Your conscious mind and your subconscious mind would really be working together. But when you're addicted, your body has become the mind, and your body is overriding the conscious brain. But if you're addicted to certain emotions in your life, I don't know, guilt or shame or unworthiness or insecurity or rage or frustration, then by definition of the quantum model, we use the people and conditions in our life to reaffirm our emotional addictions so that we can remember who we are as a somebody. So then when people go with their conscious will, like they make a declaration, I'm going to be no longer a victim today, I'm going to live in a state of grace, they start out with really good intentions, but you know, remember, if the body's become the mind and it's not getting its emotional addiction, the body's going to send signals to the brain, and then you walk back into your life and you see the person that you use to reaffirm your guilt or your frustration, just like being in the presence of the chocolate cake. The moment you see that person, if you're addicted to that emotion and you're using them to reaffirm it, just like being in the presence of the chocolate cake, your body's going to physiologically, autonomically, automatically, subconsciously return back to the old chemical self. In other words, you're going to go unconscious. So it takes an act of willfulness to make the choice. And as we talk in a little bit, when we make a choice to change, we have to make a choice that has such an amplitude or intensity of energy that the amplitude of choice becomes the experience that literally begins to be greater than the hardwired programs in the brain and the emotional addictions in the body. And the body has to respond to a new mind. In other words, the hair on the back of your neck has to stand up, and the body, as the animal, has to say, uh-oh, she's serious this time. It's not you sitting on the couch with your smartphone here and your computer here and your remote control and your, I think I'm going to change tomorrow. The body's like, relax, she's lying to herself again. Nothing's going to change. So the act of willfulness is one component. But what our research shows is that where the programs exist, they exist in the subconscious, right? And it's in the body-mind. So then the purpose of meditation, as we talked about last time, is to get beyond the conscious mind, past the analytical mind, into the subconscious mind where those programs exist. And that's the purpose of meditation, to get beyond the analytical mind. Now you're in the operating system. And so as you become conscious of your unconscious thoughts, as you begin to pay attention to your behaviors and notice your emotions, you're actually going into the operating system and bringing them to your conscious awareness. Why? Because you don't want those to slip by your awareness ever again. So then when you begin to decide then how you do on a program, and you begin to teach your body emotionally what wealth feels like, what freedom feels like, what nobility is like, when you begin to plan your behaviors in your day, the act of rehearsing who you're going to be installs the neurological circuits in your brain. You're priming your brain so you have something to use when you open your eyes. And when you begin to think about what thoughts you do want to think about and fire and wire in your brain, how you think, how you act, and how you feel is your personality, and your personality creates your personal reality. Now, your job is to get up from your meditation differently than when you sat down, and you have to be in a new state of being, so that when you walk back into your life and you've overcome your guilt or you've overcome your frustration and the body's no longer living in the past, it's now living in the future. The moment that happens, you can walk in the presence of your greatest adversary, your greatest enemy, the person you use to reaffirm your addiction, and you have no physiological response anymore because you did the work to overcome yourself.
Why do we keep doing that same habit?
Well, a habit is a redundant set
of automatic, unconscious thoughts, behaviors, and emotions that's acquired through repetition. A habit is when you've done something so many times that your body literally knows how to do it better than your mind. Turns out, by the time we're 35 years old, we're a set of memorized programs. And so the body is functioning and the mind is unconscious. So then when there's crisis or there's trauma or there's disease or diagnosis or loss, the event sometimes causes people to feel so differently than themselves that they can finally see themselves through the eyes of somebody else. Now, that moment in neuroscience is called metacognition. This is the moment where we start paying attention to how we think. We start thinking about what we're thinking about. We start noticing how we're acting, how we're speaking. We start becoming aware of the emotions that we live by. And the moment you start observing those states of mind and body, you're no longer the program. You're the consciousness observing that program. And we begin to objectify our subjective self. In other words, you can't read the label when you're inside the jar. You got to get out of the jar to be able to see who you are. So most people wait for that moment where they feel so bad that they could finally begin to make an effort to change. And of course, times are changing. Mm-hmm. And my message is, why wait? Why not just start creating a future every day and begin to think differently? Begin to act differently and begin to feel differently. And if you do that enough times, that becomes the new habit.
It becomes the new habit, but when the crisis, because things are so accelerated now, and the more that we get into crisis, that I think it's like a wheel. You just spin, or I just spin. I'm not going to say you. When that upset happens, say you're in the state of coherence and it's great, and then, you know, there's a loss of a loved one, or there's a flood in your house, or something breaks the state that's not small.
Sure. Well, I mean, we may not be able to control everything in our outer world,
right,
but we certainly can control our inner world. And so it's not so important to not react. I mean, everybody reacts. I react. The question is, how long are you going to react? So if you keep an emotional reaction going on for an extended period of time, you're memorizing that emotion, and your body, as the unconscious mind, is believing it's living in the same past experience 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. The body doesn't know the difference between the real experience that produces the emotion and the emotion that we create by thought alone. So then the emotion then reaffirms the state, and then people start to use the problems and the conditions in their life to keep that emotion going, and I would call that an addiction. So we become addicted to the very life we don't even like. So it's important then for people to realize then, when you have that moment where you have crisis or something breaks down, that you do have control over it, and it's a formula and it's a skill, and our research shows that you can teach people how to do that. And so then when you're living by some emotion, there'll always be a gap between the way things appear and the way things really are. Emotions alter our perception. And if you act during that time, you'll always say the same thing. I should have never said that. I should have never done that. I should have never thought that. I should have never sent that email. So then shortening your emotional reactions is a level of intelligence then that causes you then to recalibrate. Because most people don't think they have control over that. They'll say, that person did it to me. That
right.
circumstance is the reason I am this way. Then I would say, if something in your outer environment is controlling your thoughts and feelings, then you're a victim to your environment.
Yeah.
And yet, how you think and feel creates your outer world. So if you're thinking and feeling equal to everything that's known in your present personal reality, you keep creating more of the same. So to change then is to think and feel greater than the conditions in your environment.